Thank you, Glenda. Good morning, everybody. I'd like to welcome you to the Hampton United Methodist Church today, and I'd like to extend a warm welcome to our KLMJ radio listeners and those who will be joining us on Facebook. This is a lovely day, isn't it? For God is good
all
the time. All the time,
God is good.
I just feel like something good is about to happen. I just feel like something good is on its way. Promise that he'd open all of heaven, and brother, it should happen any day. When God's people humble themselves to call on Jesus, and they look to heaven expecting as they pray, I just feel like something good is about to happen, and brother, this could be the very day. Please join me in the call to worship. The covenant love of God is steadfast and everlasting. God's concern for us and for the world knows no end. The attention of God to our needs is constant and never failing. God's faithfulness endures forever. Let us pay attention to God, who is forever attending to us. Let us worship God and celebrate God's goodness. Please join me in hymn number 467, Trust and Obey.
Seated. You can smell it, right?
the after worship fellowship lunch just makes you wish the preacher would hurry up and get done. You're all invited downstairs to lunch after the service. On Tuesday at 1:30 will be the funeral service for Joe Nearing, and we invite you to come to honor her. Our scripture reading this day comes from Judges, the 4th chapter, verses 1 through 16 from the Common English Bible. The Israelites again did things that the Lord saw as evil. So the Lord gave them over to the king of Canaan. The commander of his army was Sisera. The Israelites cried out to the Lord because Sisera had 900 iron chariots and had oppressed the Israelites cruelly for 20 years. Now Deborah, a prophet, was a leader of Israel at that time. She would sit under Deborah's palm tree, and the Israelites would come to her to settle disputes. She sent word to Barak and said to him, "Hasn't the Lord, Israel's God, issued you a command? Go and assemble at Mount Tabor, taking 10,000 men with you. I'll lure Sisera to assemble with his chariots and troops against you, and then I'll help you overpower him." Barak replied to her, "If you'll go with me, I'll go. But if not, I won't go." Deborah answered, "I'll definitely go with you. However, the path you're taking won't bring honor to you, because the Lord will hand over Sisera to a woman." Then Deborah got up and went with Barak. 10,000 men marched out behind him. Deborah marched out with him too. When it was reported to Sisera that Barak had marched up to Mount Tabor, Sisera summoned all of his 900 iron chariots and all of the soldiers who were with him. Then Deborah said to Barak, "Get up. This is the day that the Lord has handed Sisera over to you. Hasn't the Lord gone out before you?" So Barak went down from Mount Tabor with 10,000 men behind him. The Lord threw Sisera and all the chariots and army into a panic before Barak. Sisera himself got down from his chariot and fled on foot. Barak pursued the chariots and the army, killing Sisera's entire army with a sword. No one survived. This is God's word for God's people.
Thanks be to God. Please join me for our prayer hymn, number 349. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, and we will sing it twice. Join us for the congregational prayer. Creating God, help us to remember that the work of prayer, the work of love, the work of encouragement, and the work of visioning are of utmost value in the family, church, and worldwide community. O God, who convicts us of our sin, that we may in humility seek forgiveness, help us to change our ways. Thank you, O God, for forgiving our sin, that we may be free of guilt and in joy and thanksgiving live new lives to your glory. We pray in the name of the one who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Please join me for hymn number 369, Blessed Assurance.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song. Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending, ring from above, echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I in my Savior am happy and blessed. Watching and waiting, looking above, filled with his goodness, lost in his love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
You may be seated. Do you know what the difference is between a preacher and a windmill? What? Oh, no, that's not it. I'll tell you in a moment. Talk about suspense. I've been waiting all week, you know, to figure out what kind of mischievous fun I can be up to since I've been quarantined. Oh, you know how terrible it is to be quarantined with me for 5 days? All by my lonesome? They think I was sick. And the worst part about it is that it only took me 3 hours each day to get up and get dressed. I'm practicing for retirement. Actually, I did very well through all of that. Mostly it was just a cough and sore throat and feeling tired. But beyond that, I was okay. And yesterday was my first day of freedom. So for the next 5 days, whenever I'm around people, I have to wear this thing, so don't get too close. I don't know why, but That's just what they tell me. Now, do you know what the difference is between a preacher and a windmill? You have to think back, because of wind turbines, you know, they're everywhere nowadays. But you have to think back to windmills. And usually they were by water, right? And windmills used the wind to get the water to flowing around mills and other places. And preachers use water to get the wind flowing. I have that just in case, you know, today. Let us pray. A God of grace, you show your grace as you choose us to live for you day to day. Show us from your word this day how we can best live your grace in our world. Come by your Holy Spirit and open your word to us while opening us body, mind, and spirit to your word, giving us the grace to hear your word and the love to let all other words sift away. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. This morning we continue our series of looking at women of the Old Testament. We understand it, at least in small town, rural Iowa. Places become identified with people. A number of years ago, Dr. Richard Jensen came to Cresco, Iowa, and he used to say when asking directions, and people would give him landmarks, he would say, "Don't tell me who lived there 30 years ago. Tell me who lives there now." But we all know that in order for a place to be associated with us, we have to have lived there for at least 30 years and then moved away for it to be associated with us, or otherwise it's associated with whoever lived there before. Not so with some people. There are some people who seem larger than life. And when they move into the neighborhood, the house takes their name. Deborah was that kind of person. Place her anywhere, and before long, her mark is so indelibly linked with that location that inhabitants forget what they once called it and simply call it by her name. Deborah's press release is short. She is a prophetess, wife of Lapidoth, and she was judging Israel under that palm tree. What palm tree? Deborah's palm tree, right. It bore her name. Proof. The scripture says, she sent and summoned Barak, son of Abinoam from Kadesh and Naphtali, and said to him, "The Lord, the God of Israel, commands you." And I interrupt the sentence midway because the rest is detail, as if that wasn't just detail already. I pause where I have because the sentence makes clear that Deborah knew who she was and that she was utterly confident that God was with her. Have you ever known anyone like that? Knowing who they are and utterly confident that God is with them? Let me suggest that most people who seem that way are simply acting their faith. It was 39 years ago, I know because I stopped and counted back the years. It was 39 years ago we were in our very first appointment as ordained pastors in the Salvation Army. Now, we had already been the equivalent of local licensed pastors in three different denominations, including the Salvation Army. But this was our very first as ordained pastors in the Salvation Army. And there was a senior adult daycare meeting in the building with a director who was an avowed atheist. Now, you might ask, how was there an atheist as the director of a senior adult daycare meeting in the Salvation Army? And the reason was, they received federal funding, so they couldn't ask about her religious affiliation, nor could they get rid of her once she made it known that she was an avowed atheist. She went out of her way, I thought, to tell us how much she did not believe in God. And shortly after we arrived, the building went through a massive remodeling project. I thought they were trying to tell me something when the first thing they did was dig a 6-foot deep trench outside my office with just a plank going across it to get in and out. I kept my eye out and listened intently just in case somebody was tempted to remove the plank once I was inside the office. But the entire church was being remodeled, and the adult daycare took all of their supplies, everything they had, and they packed them away in boxes. And they moved them to a back room in the church, and they stacked them up. And so here in this room, it was a large room, there was row upon row of boxes stacked. And one day, the director came to me, and she asked me if I would help find some needles in that storeroom. I said, sure, and I went with her. And when we got to the room, I looked at the row upon row of boxes, and I said, okay, which box are the needles in? And she said, that's why I brought you. We didn't list the contents of each box when we put these things in them. So I don't know which box they're in, she said. I thought you could pray and God would show you which box to save us time. I think she was only half joking given her track record, but what was I to do? I prayed. I prayed out loud, oh Lord, show me which box. And after pausing for a few seconds, I pointed to a box at the bottom of a stack of boxes and said, they are in there. I have to confess to you that back then I was young and dumb. Now I'm just old and dumb. I had no idea if the needles were in that box or not. It was just as good as any other box. She watched as I dug out that box and I opened it up and began going through it, and lo and behold, in the bottom of that box were the needles she was looking for. I really think God was having a joke on me. But it's made a good sermon illustration for 39 years. Sometimes when we act our faith, when we act on our faith, God comes through in miraculous ways. And by the way, in case you're wondering if she ever came to faith, I don't know. As far as I know, she never did. Barak knew Deborah's reputation. That's why he came when he was summoned. He knew of her faith, but he wasn't taking any chances. Literally, he said, if you're so convinced that I am the person to do this, then prove it by coming with me. And so, Deborah did. And the rest was history, except for one thing. After the battle was won, Barak and Deborah sang a duet. I will make melody to the Lord, the God of Israel. They sang along with a whole lot of other words. Imagine them singing after a grueling, bloody battle. They must have been Irish Jews. Now let's talk about Deborah, or at least let me talk about Deborah. Where did God find Deborah? And don't tell me under Deborah's palm tree. We aren't really told, but most probably God found her in some ordinary place. That's the way God works. God specializes in finding his chosen ones in ordinary places. Moses was born in a slave hut. Jesus was born in a stable. John Wesley was born in a parsonage. Norman Borlaug, who I've mentioned before, was born in a little out-of-the-way town in Iowa. We don't have to come from noble beginnings, nor from large metropolitan areas for God to find us when he wants to use us. We just have to be ready for God to use us. And that was Deborah. She was ready for God to use her. And it may be that we need to know no more than that she was available. It's a story about a man who applied for a job as a handyman. The prospective employer asked, "Can you do carpentry?" And the man answered in the negative. "How about bricklaying?" And again, the man answered, "No." The employer asked, "Well, what about electrical work?" And the man said, "No, I don't know anything about that either." Finally, the employer said, "Well, tell me then, what is handy about you?" And the man replied, "I live just around the corner." Sometimes the greatest ability we can have is availability. To be where God can call us, to be within whisper range of his summons. And that's the beginning of a life of meaningful discipleship. Deborah understood that. She was available. Besides being a person who was available to God, Deborah was also a person who listened to God. So often when we talk about Old Testament prophets and prophetesses, say that three times fast, we emphasize that they spoke for God. But first, they had to listen to God if they were going to speak for him. I've used this story before, but it bears repeating here. The story is told of Franklin Roosevelt, who often had to stand in long receiving lines at the White House, and he complained that no one really listened or paid any attention to what was said. And one day during a reception, he decided to try an experiment. To each person who passed down the line and shook his hand, he murmured, "I murdered my grandmother this morning." The guests responded with phrases like, "Marvelous! Keep up the good work! We're proud of you. God bless you, sir." Yeah, they really paid attention, didn't they? Wasn't until the end of the line, while greeting the ambassador from Bolivia, that his words were actually heard. Nonplussed, the ambassador leaned over and whispered, "I'm sure she had it coming." We struggle to listen to one another. Yet how much more we need to learn to listen to God. Deborah knew how to listen to God. And so she did. She listened to God. Thus far, we've seen that Deborah was chosen by God, available to God, and that she listened to God. But there's more that we can learn from the story of Deborah. Deborah was a woman of character, and her character gave her uncommon strength. She was fully committed to God and to her people, in spite of the obstacles, not the least of which is that she was a woman trying to lead in a man's world. In spite of the odds, Deborah kept believing. She was fully committed. Do we keep going when the odds seem stacked against us? There's a story of an old saint who once prayed, "Lord, when will you cease to litter my path with trials and thorns?" And the Lord answered, "My child, that is how I prove my friends." To which the suffering saint replied, "Lord, perhaps that's why you have so few of them." Now, I must tell you that I don't believe that God sends trials and thorns to test us. But I do believe that he allows them. It's in the midst of those times of deepest trials that we discover whether we are fully committed to God or not. And there, in a nutshell, is the story of Deborah. So what are we to learn? What can we apply to our lives from the story of Deborah? First, it doesn't make any difference where we begin this journey of faith. It is enough that God has found us and that we are following Jesus. Second, we must be willing to be used by God. And third, we must make sure all along the way that we are listening for and to God. And then fourth and finally, we must constantly be fully committed to God and to God's people. This morning, do we hear the call of God upon our lives? Are we committed to listening to and following Jesus? Because he still comes. He still asks us if we're able to follow him. Next hymn is 530, Are Ye Able? Please stand.
Are ye able, sir, to be crucified with me? Yea, the sturdy dreamers answered, to the death we follow thee. Lord, we are able, our spirits are thine. Remold them, make us like the divine. His pardoned soul is worthy of a place in paradise. Lord, we are able, our spirits are thine. Remold them, make us like the divine. Thy guiding radiance shall be a beacon to God.
prolific writer, Anonymous, has written these words, which you could insert the word man instead of woman, but since our lesson for today was about Deborah, I'll leave them the way that the writer penned them. A strong woman works out every day to keep her body in shape, but a woman of strength kneels in prayer to keep her soul in shape. A strong woman isn't afraid of anything, but a woman of strength shows her courage in the midst of fear. A strong woman won't let anyone get the best of her, but a woman of strength gives the best of her to everyone. A strong woman walks sure-footedly, but a woman of strength knows God will catch her when she falls. A strong woman wears the look of confidence on her face, but a woman of strength wears grace. A strong woman has faith that she is strong enough for the journey. But a woman of strength has faith that in the journey, she will become strong. Such a woman was Deborah. She knew who she was in her faith in God. And she was willing to act on that. What about us? This day and this week, let us go. Answering the call of Jesus upon our lives, let us go and live God's message of life, love, and hope for all. Now may the love of the Father, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the peace and the power of the Holy Spirit be evident in our living and in our loving through all eternity.